So I have the coveted end of the night talk as I look around and watch people leaving. Now, I would have expected that if they had heard me talk before, but usually I don't get that reaction until after I've spoken. I'm very excited about being here. I know everybody always says that, and I had to make some notes because this is not my typical talk. I've been doing a talk for a long time. I've had the honor of working and teaching at a number of business schools. And my talk generally has been about, you know, building my cookie company with, you know, no background in the food business, starting the company with only $8,000, building it to over $100 million in revenue over a period of about 20 years. All of that. Had a motorcycle accident, and I'm going to get to a little bit of that. But when they told me what the topic was, talking about the story behind the glory, first, I never thought of it as glory. I really have thought about it in a lot of different ways. But I am in the process right now of writing a book, which will be out. I'll give you all the website later. You can buy it. But I am in the process now of writing a book. It's about 90% finished. And I wasn't sure about what to say. The book is about 300 pages long. And I thought that what I would do tonight is just read it. So I better tell everyone that I'm joking because more people will start to leave. So let me just begin by saying this. There's much I want to share with you tonight. I want to really talk more about kind of how my life got me to where it is, about really going from poverty to philanthropy. I had to start work at a very early age because my family virtually had no money. I had to start working when I was 12, not to go buy toys or extra things, not even to buy clothes, but really to give money to my family so that we could survive. So when I was a kid, I got into a lot of trouble, mainly because I was always working, and I wasn't a great student because I didn't have time to do homework. And so back then, when I was a kid and got in all of this trouble, people said that I was out of control. Now they say I'm free-spirited. I was told that I didn't work well in groups, because I always wanted to tell other kids what to do. Now I have great leadership skill. I was told I'd never be successful because I always wanted to do things a different way, and now I have entrepreneurial spirit. Labels change as people accomplish different things, but the truth is, it's not allowing people to really define who you are that makes a difference in your life. So because I had to start work at such an early age, I really thought by the time I was 20 years old, I knew the answers to everything. I had run kind of a really tough track throughout my life, and I had worked for many, many companies and had always done pretty well, so I thought I knew, like, all the answers. When I was about 35, I realized that I was right. I did know all the answers. The problem was I didn't know all the questions. And there's a big difference between, in fact, knowing the answers and knowing the questions. And so for a lot of entrepreneurs, what it really comes down to is really not what you know or how your business plan lays out and all of the things that you're expecting along the way to happen. It's really about how are you going to deal with the things that you didn't expect to happen. How do you deal with getting knocked down? How do you deal with getting back up? And how many times are you really willing to get back up? Because that is what really defines the failure and success. And anyone that goes into business has got to recognize the fact that failure is just on the flip side. It doesn't take much for you to suddenly lose what it is you've been trying to build. I've been saved 4 times in my life. The first time I was saved, literally saved, I was 6 years old. My family was at the beach, and everybody was jumping off the end of a pier, and so did I. I was, like I said, I was 6. I'm not a very good swimmer. And when I jumped off the end of the pier, somebody else jumped in and went right on top of me, and I went under and was drowning. And a woman, a family friend, actually, a child of a family friend, a woman named Elaine Silverman, saw me gasping for breath and jumped in and saved me. So that was really the first time in my life that I was saved. I never really gave it much thought about how people can save your life, can make a difference in your life, until I was about 13 years old, and I was working literally 3 jobs as a kid. I'd get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I'd go to a hotel before school, and I'd put mats out on top of these beach lounge chairs, and then after I got done doing that, I got paid 50 cents an hour. Now, probably people in the audience are probably thinking, younger people are probably saying, well, 50 cents an hour, that must have been a lot of money back then. No, it was not a lot of money. It was nothing. But it was a job, and so I did that, and then I'd go to school, and then I'd come back at the end of the day and pick the mats back up, and then on the weekends I worked for our landlord, who was a handyman, but he was a licensed electrician, carpenter, and plumber, and I became his apprentice, and never knew that those things would come in handy later in my life, but in fact they did. So I did those jobs, and when I saved up a little bit of money, I used to go to this store in Miami, and I would buy clothes. And I bought clothes at this store called Dorwin's, and the guy that owned it was a guy named Irving Settler. And he was the most incredible man I think I've ever met. And anything I know to this day, I know because of him. So one of my friends worked in the store, so even when I didn't have money to buy clothes, I used to go hang out in the store. I always loved clothes. I loved the colors and the smells and everything about the clothing business. And this friend of mine, Steve, worked in the store. And one day I walked in the store, and Irving and Steve were in this argument like I've never heard in my life, and screaming. Irving was screaming at him. And he looked over at me, and I had developed a relationship with Irving over the 10 months. And he looked over at me and he said, "Kid, do you want a job?" And I said, "Yeah." I thought to myself, an air-conditioned store? I didn't have to be on that hot, sweaty beach anymore. And he said, and he looked at my friend and said, "You're fired, you're hired, when can you start?" I didn't know that that moment that Irving Settler would be the second person to save my life. Because the truth is, when you're a poor kid, and you don't have a lot of direction, when someone like that comes into your life and becomes not only a mentor, but someone that becomes almost a father figure that gives you confidence and is beginning to teach you things that you probably would never have learned any other way unless later on you got to go to business school. So from the time I was about almost 14, I went to work for this guy, and he taught me everything. I mean, he taught me about buying. He talked me about everything there was to know about that business. And, you know, the thing that was really amazing about this man is that one of the things it taught me was the amount of pride he had in his business. He came up almost the same way. He had to work when he was very young. Matter of fact, he told me one time, I said, "Irving, where did you ever get the courage, you know, to start your own business, to be an entrepreneur?" I probably didn't say entrepreneur. I probably didn't even know that word when I was, you know, 14 or 15 years old. And I looked at him and said, "How did you have the courage to do it?" He said, "Well," he said, "the truth is, I was always a pretty talented young guy. And people recognized my talent and wanted to always pay me what I was worth. And I would never work for that little." So anyway, so he knew he had to start his own business. Now, the thing about being a mentor, like he was to me, and you have this mentor program here, the thing that you're not going to realize today, for your mentees is that you may be mentoring them now, and someday you may not be in their lives, either because they've moved away or you may not be on this earth anymore. But Irving's been gone for almost 30 years, and I think about him in every situation that I get involved in. I think about his advice. I think about all the things that he taught me about how you should think about what you're doing. That's a long time ago, since I was 14. But this guy made such a tremendous difference in my life. When I was 18 years old, my brother Jerry was the third person to save my life. Because the fact that I was working all these jobs, again, I didn't have time for homework. And so most of my teachers thought that, you know, basically, this guy needs to go to trade school, you know, because he's never going to be able to do anything. And that was the kind of real encouragement I was getting. You know, go to trade school. And so my brother stepped into my life and basically said, I started at a new school, and he said, you're going to take a college-bound course. And I went, no, there's no way I can take a college-bound course. He said, no, you're going to take a college-bound course. It's my senior year of high school. And he said, no, you'll take the college-bound course because, you know, you need to go to school. And so I took all the books home, and I remember sitting in the selection office, and it was pretty easy to pick courses. You know, it was like English, history, science, and then I got to math. And math was calculus, trigonometry, algebra 2, solid geometry, and then there was a little subject down there called basic math. And I thought to myself, basic math, that's for me. And so I picked basic math, and I went around the corner to get my books, and I got all of them home, and I'm looking through English and history and science and all that, and then I get to basic math, and I open it up, and the first section is algebra 2. Basic math was all of those subjects in one course. And I said to my brother, there's no way, I can't do this. And he said, no, you can do it. We'll go to the library. And that's what we did. But I went to the library, and I got, as each course came up, I'd go to the library. He'd work with me. And, you know, again, this is not about bragging or anything like that, but it was someone who stepped into my life and said, no, you can do this. And I wound up being an honor student my senior year of high school. And so much so that my guidance counselor, who knew my background, worked so hard to help me not only get into college, but in fact to get a scholarship when I was going to be able to go to school. And so, but the part of that story is I never wound up going. Business stepped into my life through circuitous circumstances, and I took a job that I figured I would probably try to get if I got out of college, because I had a lot of experience in the business. So I took that job, and it worked out very, very well. I was in the fashion clothing business, was very successful in it. It was a crazy time to be in the fashion clothing business. I'm sure you've seen, you know, things like Runway and shows like that. A lot of fun, a lot of money back in the 70s. A lot of drugs, a lot of women, everything in the world that could be good, but also in excess. And so I found my life going down a track that I had never experienced, and honestly could have gone in a very bad way until the fourth person saved my life. And that was my wife, Donna, who's here tonight. And I met Donna, and literally my life flipped. It was like everything that I knew was important, I knew was still important, but suddenly there was another part of my life that had equal importance, and that was my wife, my family, raising my kids, and having a much more stable life, a life, frankly, that I never knew as I was growing up, because of the kind of family problems that my mother and my dad had financially. So, what does all this mean? You know, so how do you wind up having the kind of determination, you know, to leave the clothing business? And I left it because I wanted to spend more time with my family and go into a business I had no idea about, which was cookies. Now, let me tell you all something. When we started that company, we didn't have a single person tell us, oh, that's a good idea. Actually, it was the opposite. Every person we went to said, you people, you're crazy. I mean, you're going to sell cookies for 30 cents and pay $25,000 a year rent at a mall. You know how many cookies that is? But the point is that we were not bakers. We were not in the bakery business, like so many of the companies that started. I was a retailer. I didn't know anything about the parts of the business I would have to learn, but I did know one thing. I knew that if you took care of customers, if you gave them lots of choices and great merchandise, you could be successful, and that's what we did. Now, what I didn't tell you is that right after we started the company, I had a motorcycle accident. I was told I would never walk again unaided, and I wound up with a self-styled rehabilitation program that not only changed my business life, but changed my physical life. I wound up, in fact, going through a different type of rehab program, got myself back on my feet, not only learned to walk again, but in the process of building the company to the national success that it became, I set 3 world records riding across the United States on a bicycle from Savannah to San Diego. I broke a record in 82, then broke my record by 4 days in 84, and then in 1989, I joined a 4-man team to do the Race Across America, which went from LA to New York, 3,000 miles. We won the race, crossed the country in 5 days, 1 hour, 8 minutes. It's the fastest crossing of America ever, and the fastest 3,000 miles ever covered under human power, and both of my records still stand today. So I tell you that part of my story, because I love to tell that part of my story. No, but I tell you that part of my story because the truth is it was still about being an entrepreneur. It was still about building a team. It was still about setting goals. It was still about everyone pulling in the same direction, which is what we have to do every day in business. If you're the leader of a company, you're going to wind up, if the company does well, you're going to wind up with the most benefit. It's about how do you bring that team along with you. You've got to make sure you're taking care of those people so that they feel that they are part of something that's bigger than they are. And the last thing I want to say to you is this. It is absolutely about the unexpected things that may happen in your life. My whole life has been about the unexpected. Everything that has happened to me, good and bad, I never expected. And everybody sitting out there has those kind of days, weeks, months, years. I know for me that, and the storm, my book, the title of my book is Facing Goliath. And what I would like to just close with, and I hope we have some time for Q&A, but what I would like to say is this, the first story I ever remember hearing about overcoming adversity was the story of David and Goliath. And a lot of people, all they talk about is the fact that David slayed the giant. But the truth of the matter is that never hit me that way. Even as a little kid, what always amazed me was that this enormous giant with armor and weapons, and David's walked into the valley with nothing but a slingshot and a few stones. The thing that always got me was that he had the courage to step into the valley. Without knowing what the outcome would be, he stepped into the valley, and each of us every single day face our own Goliath challenges, whether it's starting a new business, losing weight, getting back into shape, going back to school, going to college, whatever it may be, those are Goliath challenges. And each one of us has just got to ask this one question. Do do you have the courage to step into the valley? Thank you.
Thank you, Michael and Donna.
When I first came up and heard the words entrepreneur, a lot of you may not remember this, back in the 60s, when a lot of entrepreneurial companies were being bought by bigger companies, the first thing those bigger companies do is threw the entrepreneurs out because they figured engineers and accountants could run the businesses much better. They learned very quickly that that was not the case. And I think, you know, back then, I mean, being an entrepreneur was honestly, it was like one step above being a drug dealer, maybe. You know, it was not a kind word for a lot of people. But the truth is that I think that entrepreneurs today are different. They in fact are business people. And you know, back in the day, I mean, and I was one of them. I mean, I was an entrepreneur. I did stuff for, you know, 2-3 years. Like either some I got promoted or I sold a business. And when I had the cookie company and I was 7 years into it, which honestly, I thought we would have sold it by 7 years and I would have been gone doing something else. And the bottom line was I was there and I was like, you know what? I want to see if I can take this to the next level. I want to see if I can do it. Have a managing business with entrepreneurial spirit. And I think that if you're going to be an entrepreneur today, you also have to be a business person, but you can't lose that vision of where you want to take the company. And you know, everybody talks about focus groups and all of that. You know, Steve Jobs, I think it was Steve Jobs that said it best. He said, if you want to figure out what the future is, you know, make the future, make it yourself. And so I don't know that there's a distinction between those two things. So.
Excellent, very, very good question, articulate answer. We're actually going to make this the final question.
Michael, I want to know, how did you get David Simon to give you prime real estate in all his malls?
you got, how much time do you have? We begged, literally begged, for our first location because it was at Perimeter Mall. And Perimeter Mall back in 1977 had gone from being one of the best malls in Atlanta to the worst mall in Atlanta. It was doing about $65 a square foot when an average mall was doing about $100. And even they didn't want to lease us the space because they just figured we'd fail. And they finally, you know, just gave in. And we got into that first mall. And the first 30 days we were in business, we had to do $12,000 to break even. We did about $30,000. And instead of having to go begging for locations, we had developers from all over the country offering us locations, and it was an amazing transition because in just 6 weeks, 8 weeks that we were in business, we were the highest grossing cookie company in the United States and stayed the highest grossing cookie company in all the years we ran the business. So.
Excellent. So hold on, I lied. There's one more question by our president.
You know, I've heard poverty to wealth. I haven't heard poverty to philanthropy. So can you talk a little bit about what you do?
A philanthropy? Yeah, my favorite. It's actually my favorite subject. You know, I've always lived by, and even my family, when I say poor, we were poor, but my mother was very involved with like the PTA, and she was a very good baker, and so she would bake stuff for bake sales. My dad was not that involved because he was just trying to earn a living. So I saw my mother do that, and I always got this sense that, you know, you've got to be involved. And I think companies need to be good corporate stewards of where they live. You know, we make money off of the communities we live in, and we've got to try to give back absolutely every way we possibly can. I believe in the three W's, which is work, wisdom, and wealth. And when Donna and I got together, you know, at first it was work. We didn't have any money to give anybody, but we were able to go work and do things. And then, Donna did, but I don't know about me having any wisdom. But we, you know, we worked hard to try to give people a different direction and try to look to the future and how you could change things, be transformational. And then when we were successful and we were able to give money. But here's the one thing I would say about that. Writing a check is easy. That's the easiest thing you do. When I sit here and say be good corporate citizens, I don't mean just write a check. I mean, yeah, write a check, but get involved. Make a difference in the lives of the communities that you serve in that are good to you. Make a difference in those lives. And I've lived by this adage, seriously, almost my entire life. Try to make a difference in the lives of people you will never meet. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Michael.